I was born in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. My family was really from Middletown, which is a small town due east of Harrisburg towards Philadelphia. My mother divorced my father during World War II and then remarried, and they moved to Hummelstown, where they lived above the gas station on the square. The building is still there today. I grew up in kind of an idyllic children's background. I could go visit my Aunt Loma and Uncle Cal on a farm. The family would rent a cabin every summer up in the mountains in central Pennsylvania. Go see my grandmothers and get sugar cookies and wander around. I grew up around a lot of adults, so it was very comfortable for me to go talk to adults all the time. There was one older woman who would always, have cookies and milk and talk to me and show me her books and all that. And I would make up very wild stories, which I realized in retrospect she did not believe any of. But it made her happy. It was a part of small town America. When my dad was in Korea, and this was a much safer and calmer time, my mother let me take a bus, I think I was 10 at the time, and go downtown to Harrisburg to see an animal film. And I watched it. I remember it was a double feature. I came out of this double feature about 4 o'clock, 4:30 in the afternoon, and it was a very sunny day. And there was a sign next to the theater that pointed through an alleyway and said City Hall. I thought, my grandmother always told me to be a good citizen, so maybe I should go through there to City Hall and explain that we needed a zoo. I was very pumped up about animals. So I wandered through and I went up to the old City Hall building. Went in and there's this nice young lady sitting at reception, and I said, where do I go about zoos? And she said, well, I guess that would be the Parks Department. So I went upstairs to the Parks Department, and he said they used to have a zoo in Wildwood Park, and he pulled out the records from before World War II and showed what it cost to feed a lion and what it cost to feed a zebra, and they closed it because of rationing during World War II. He picked up the phone and called my grandmother and said, your grandson is here. I'm going to put him in a cab, but he has to come back Tuesday and testify at City Council, because that's what citizens do.
As you can imagine, the local newspaper reported on his appearance before the council. And his father, who was serving in the army in Korea, wrote his mother and said, keep him out of the newspapers.
He wanted to be a zookeeper as a child, and then it sort of evolved into donating animals to the Atlanta Zoo. He's donated a white rhino, an emerald tree boa. I mean, he just can't help himself. He just loves animals. He's passionate about them.
When he was in high school, he had a dog named Pride. And so when Dad and Pride were out walking one day, it was winter, and so the pond was frozen, and Pride got out into the pond and fell through the ice into the water. So Pride couldn't get up, just his two front little paws could get up. So Dad, worried about his dog, of course, went out into the ice to try to pull Pride up. Well, what happened is Dad went into the water as well. And Pride, when he came up, of course, dogs being smarter than humans, the Pride was already up on the ice when Dad finally came up and pulled himself out as well. So when Dad tells the story, he talks about that he learned not to panic because he was literally under the ice, and if he panicked, he wouldn't be able to get back out. But what I've learned from this story, and what I think it shows, is what an incredible person he is. It's a window into his heart and shows you that a man who would risk his life to save his dog is an incredible person.
I think I was interested in everything. I still am. And I think history is one of the ways of experiencing life. You had the state capitol, so that gave you some sense of politics and history. You had Philadelphia not that far away, so you had the Constitution and Independence Hall. Gettysburg was about 50 miles south of us, so you had the largest battle in the Civil War. All these things kind of flowed around us. And of course, I was born in 1943, so I grew up in the shadow of World War II and began to be conscious of the world during the Korean War. So there was a sense of how real things were, and how much more people paid attention to those things than they do today. The first real break was moving to Fort Riley, where we spent 3 years. I was between 10 and 13. And we lived on base in what were then called very modern, they were called Capehart housing after Senator Capehart. My dad was a junior officer. And directly behind us up on a hill was the Army training area. And so as a kid, when they weren't on maneuvers, you could go up and wander around. I mean nowadays it would be a nightmare because of the safety. I mean, I used to climb around on tanks that they were using for rifle grenade practice. And you just wander around these areas that have been churned up by armored vehicles. But it was a great adventure.
As a young Army brat, Newt was surrounded by people willing to sacrifice their lives for America and the cause of freedom. In April of 1958, while his family was living in Orléans, France, his father took them to the battlefield of Verdun, the largest battlefield of World War I, where 600,000 men died in a 9-month period.
By comparison, that's the total dead in the entire American Civil War in 4 years. And you just had the sense that this stuff's all real, that countries can die, and that bad leadership can be disastrous. And so I spent the summer thinking and praying about it, and I decided in August of 58 that I would spend my life on three things. What do we need to do in order to survive as a free country? How would you explain it to the American people so they'd give you permission? And how would you actually implement it if they gave you permission?
I think it became very vivid that individuals have responsibilities. And that for him, it was almost a calling that he would pursue education that would prepare him for a life in leadership.
If you're really searching for lessons and trying to understand how people successfully deal with big challenges, then you immerse yourself in learning. One of the great problems of the House of Representatives is that people come in there and promptly run for governor, run for the Senate. So there's a permanent loss of energy and talent, and that somebody who stayed and focused on the House could actually make a big impact. I think at that stage, I just wanted to be in the House and be effective, because that and the Senate and the President are the three key operating blocks of the way the system works.
The Honorable Newt Gingrich of the state of Georgia is duly elected Speaker of the House of Representatives for the 104th Congress, having received a majority of the votes cast.
If we'll recognize that in this building we symbolize America writ small, that we have an obligation to talk with each other, then I think a year from now we can look on the 104th Congress as a truly amazing institution. And without regard to party, without regard to ideology, we can say here America comes to work, and here we are preparing for those children a better future.
The effect of 1994 was very big. First of all, you shifted from liberal chairman to conservative, from liberal speaker to conservative, from a liberal agenda to conservative. You changed the underlying dynamic of the two parties. We'd had 40 years of one-party domination in the House. The Democrats literally thought that it was inconceivable that they could lose. And 94 was an enormous shock to them. They thought they had owned the House. And literally, on the very first couple of days, Democrats would come in and sit in the chairman's seat, and the staff would have to say, no, you're now the ranking member. I mean, it was that big a sea change.
Under his leadership as Speaker, we balanced the budget, we cut taxes, we reformed welfare, we cut spending. I mean, we had huge accomplishments. So he was incredibly successful.
What I love most about my father would be that he's a lifelong learner, he's courageous, he's wise, he's fun.
So what I love most is that he's really fun, he's really smart, he has great experience, and he loves being with his family. We really have a great time with him.
And he really loves us.
Well, first of all, I'm very proud of both Kathy and Jackie, because they're remarkable women, and they've had great professional lives. And Kathy's run companies. Jackie's written two books and writes a weekly column. It's a real joy to campaign with them. It's a real joy when they and their husbands come. And of course, Jackie has our two grandchildren, Maggie and Robert. You know, when we all get together, whether it's for a debate or for some other purpose, it's just a lot of fun to all be there doing things together. Let me tell you about Calista, who is my wife. She's my partner. I would say she's remarkably attractive. She is very perfectionist in almost every way. It's the way she plays the piano, it's the way she plays the French horn, it's singing in the Basilica Choir, it's campaigning. I mean, it's almost ironic. I've campaigned for a long time. She has an automatic instinct, and she's actually very good at it. Her father was genetically very inclined to talk to everybody, and she picked up what we call the Ollie gene, and she's very good at it. To a degree that surprises me, she's really captured American exceptionalism, and she's really made it a part of her own value system and her own way of thinking, and everything from writing Sweet Land of Liberty, which we were thrilled to have as a New York Times bestseller, to making the movies together.
Newt and I share a passion for America. Everything I know about the history of our country and our core values has led me to believe that we are an exceptional nation and people. Growing up in Whitehall, Wisconsin, an all-American Midwestern town, it was impossible not to be instilled with a sense of patriotism. Our understanding and appreciation of what we are as a nation determines our policies, our values, and whether or not we teach our children that we are a special nation.
I don't think I could have done this campaign without Calista. She really gets up every morning determined to be happy and with an attitude that says, look, you know, you're alive and you're well, and why wouldn't you be happy?
Newt is well known publicly as an historian, and some of the things he talks about most ardently is the role of faith in the lives of our founding fathers and the foundation of our country. He talks about faith in the life of Abraham Lincoln. But what I think people little understand is that this discussion, this talk about faith, is motivated by a living faith that Newt has. This is a faith that animates his life today. He is passionate about the faith of our founding fathers. He's passionate about the God-given rights that were set forth in the Declaration of Independence, because as a person of a living faith, he understands how vital it is to every person, how vital it is to the life of a nation.
I think faith is central to my identity and to my being. And I think all my whole life I've prayed before every major decision or every major activity or before speeches. And I think it allows me to, in a sense, relax into God. I mean, to not carry the burdens myself, to not think that I am alone.
Over the last several months, we have had the privilege of visiting with many wonderful people across the country, learning about their concerns and hopes for our nation. As we listen and learn, it's evident that most Americans are still optimistic about the future of our country. The greatest challenge facing our country and the next president of the United States is job creation and the growth of our economy. As our nation faces long-term unemployment, resulting in millions of jobless Americans, it's imperative that we elect a president who can put America back to work. Let's give a warm decorum welcome to my husband and best friend, Newt Gingrich.
I think that I am the one person who understands how big the changes have to be for America to succeed. And I think I'm the one person who's had the background of actually achieving very large-scale projects.
We want to run not a Republican campaign, we want to run an American campaign. Because we are optimistic about the future, because America has always been optimistic about the future.
I'm running for president because I think we are in enormous danger of losing America as a country that's exceptional. I think we're in enormous danger of losing our economic vitality, losing our national security, and ultimately losing our freedom. And I think we need a leader who understands what has made America great and who is prepared to unleash the American people to go back to rebuilding the country that we love.